trade that we made. Somebody wrote a song, I think, about it. Said, lay down that old coat and put on a new. Amen. I traded nothing for everything. What a deal. What a deal. God is so good, isn't he? Amen. So happy that you're here today. Also, we have our Crossing Point ministry, and we're going to be hitting you next month on that one, okay? We're going to be asking you to help us. And it's not that big. We just have, I think, about 11 boys up there. We're going to try our best. We went last year and had a little Christmas banquet with them. We took all of them a modest gift bag with socks and bottles and candy, I think. Something like that. So that's going to take place probably the second Tuesday next month. So it's not like put that on your plate. Amen. Praise God. Isn't God good?
Amen.
Hallelujah. If you'd like to stand for the reading of God's Word, we're going to be reading out of Colossians. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 through 19. Colossians 1, 16 through 19. For by Him were all things created, that are in the heaven, that are in the earth, visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by Him and for Him. And He is before all things, and by Him all things consist. And He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things He might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in Him should all fullness dwell. For in Him should all fullness dwell. Praise God. Would you stretch your hand and pray for your pastor today? Father God, I pray, God, today for that divine unction that comes only through the Spirit of God. Father, I love you today, and I love the church, I love the people, and Father, I feel their love toward me and my family. And I thank God for that, and Lord, today I just ask you to just touch us together, just mold us together here today as we hear from your word, and let us leave here today saying it was good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen and amen. Tell your neighbor, say neighbor.
Neighbor.
The pastor needs all your prayers and all your amens. And everybody said amen.
Oh,
hallelujah. Praise God. Glory to God. Amen. In Him should all the fullness dwell. Amen. I believe that we just need to hear a little out of the Word of God to let us know that man, though serving God and living for God and walking on this earth in the day that we live, is the best times that we could ever have. If you don't know Jesus, you haven't even begun to live. If you haven't taken time to say, Lord, I've messed up everything, and all of us do. All of us have. I've messed up everything, but God, here's all the pieces. Would you just put them back together and put them in the place that they need to be? And God, I'll serve you and live for you. That's what it means to be a Christian, doesn't it? Amen. That doesn't mean you never mess up, because we mess up occasionally. But grace is there. God's grace, God's divine enablement. God doing for us what we cannot do for ourselves. That's what grace really is. Amen. God does for you what you can't do. You can't save yourself. No, you can't. You can't live good enough, right enough, holy enough. Amen. It takes the blood of Jesus. For it's by grace through faith that we're saved, not of ourselves. It is a gift of God. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 tells us that. For he's got not of ourselves, lest any man would boast. But I feel today that the psalmist, he sort of had it summed up. King David, I don't know if he wrote this psalm or had it commissioned it to be written, But he said in Psalm 16 and 11, that thou wilt show me the path of life. Thou wilt show me the path of life. And in thy presence is fullness of joy. In the presence of God is fullness of joy. And he went on to say, at thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Hallelujah. Oh, amen. You know, his benefits are out of this world. His benefits are not only in this world, but out of this world. There's a place called heaven. There's a place Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. And he said, if it were not true, I would have told you. And I'm going away, but I'm coming back. Oh, and he's waiting and looking for his son to return. Oh, yes. Praise God. I don't know that he was born on December the 25th exactly. Nobody knows for sure. And most real smart theologians say, no, it wasn't possible for him to do that. But he was born one day. But one day he's coming back. Wouldn't it be something if he'd come back on this Christmas day? Wouldn't it be something if he'd come back before Christmas day? Wouldn't it be great if he'd just come back today? Oh, yes. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He's coming. He's coming. Praise God. Well, Thanksgiving's over with, and Black Friday. Oh, man, everybody got out and got those good deals, you know, those Black Friday deals, the hustle, the bustle. Nobody can get beat up or nothing, did they? Amen. Trying to, yeah. Some people trying, you know, a few years ago, people trying to get through the Walmart doors first. They got two or three fights and all that stuff going on. I remember back in the 80s when our kids were this small, they had on TV when people fighting over them cabbage patch dogs. Amen. Oh, Lord have mercy. But it's all hit, and it's hit pretty hard, and it's went pretty fast, but it's all gone. Amen. I read of an ad that was put in the paper. It's actually went back a couple of years ago of the point that I was reading. But this took place over in England, but it could happen right here in the United States. And maybe this is a good word today for somebody that's looking for a job. But there was an ad put in the paper, Help Wanted ad, seeking part-time worker with a very specific set of skills. And what they wanted you to do was to be a Christmas light untangler. Yeah, I mean, really, there's no joke. This really was an ad put in the paper. People, they were looking. This food corporation, sort of like Food City, they were going to advertise, we're going to untangle your Christmas lights. We'll untangle. The ad called for a candidate that could untangle a 10-foot stretch of Christmas lights in less than 3 minutes. The job would be, didn't say what it would pay, but it would be at least 36 hours per week, and the person must also be passionate about Christmas. Can you see me being passionate about something, trying to untangle Christmas, 10-foot piece of Christmas lights in less than 3 minutes? You think I could do it, Tristan? No, I couldn't do it. Not many people could. I'm sure there's some that can. You know, I get my nips out, you know. I take care of them that way. But once you nip them things, they're all gone bad. It's hard to get it to work. But that's something you might can think about. But really the point was, thinking about that, that passion, to have a passion for Christmas. Amen. I don't think I would be very passionate about Christmas doing something like that. But you know, a lot of us, some of you that are here today, there's been some things that's got tangled up in your life. Oh, it's not a 10-foot stretch of Christmas lights that you're worried about today, but it's something more important, something more detailed than that, and I don't know what it is, but you know what it is. and you're going along. You're just sort of like the man, you know, with a sack on his back. You've got a weight on you, amen, and don't seem like anybody's going to help you. But I'm going to tell you today that God said that he would help you. He said, for in him, said that in him should all fullness dwell. I want to have the fullness of God, don't you? And in this next few weeks before Christmas Day gets here, I want to go around and I want to share the love of God with people. I don't want to be down in the muddy grubs. I don't want to be down, you know, my bottom lip dragging out my tracks. But I want to go around and say, hey, thank God, Merry Christmas. Happy birthday, Jesus. I'm walking in the fullness of God. Because in him, in Jesus Christ, is all the fullness of God. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Lord. You see, it comes with him. If you have him, that's what we call Christians, being like Christ. If you have him, you've got it. Praise God. And you got Jesus. Amen. Praise God. You see, you've been looking. Some of you have been looking for the deal of the day. Some of you looked for the deal on Friday, on that Black Friday. But now that's come and gone. Some of the deals have closed up. Some of them went on another day or two. But I want to tell you, this deal's still on. Hallelujah. And it's going to be on until the Bible says there's coming a time that the angels are going to declare time shall be no more. But as long as time remains, there's going to be seed time and harvest time, and God's deal is still on. You can still get the deal, praise God, that goes beyond all even my ability to describe it to you today. John 1 and 1 sort of gets it stirred up. And then verse 14 in the Gospel of John, he said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Oh, in him it pleased the Father to put all the fullness in him. Verse 14 said, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and full of truth. Hallelujah. Oh, thank God the deal's still on. The Word came down. Jesus Christ came down. Praise God. Can you imagine back in the book of Genesis, right after the flood, when Noah's family had finally, you know, went through that flood and they came out and they offered up that first sacrifice, the first offering before God, and God made that covenant with them and said, from now on, I'll never again destroy this earth by water again. And he said, but to tell you, to show you that I'm going to keep my promise, I'm going to put a rainbow in the sky. And every time you see that rainbow, it'll just remind you of my promise. Thank God. But if you see today, there's a greater promise than no flood. There's a greater promise today, and God gives us the promise right here today, because you're in the house of God today, and God is giving you reassurance. That's what that rainbow was to Noah's day. But the Holy Spirit and us gathering together here in the name of the Lord today is that reassurance. It's going to be okay. Praise God. Troubles come. Troubles go. Heartaches happen. But hearts heal. Amen. But I tell you today, fullness, a full life. Thank God there's life after any storm. There's calm after every storm. And you can count on it. You can count on it. God is telling us, just as he told Noah and his, that generation, Noah's children and the people that sprang out from them when that rainbow, and we still see one occasionally here, don't we? And it reminds us that God's promise is still intact. God's promise is still intact for you, sir. Praise God. He said he'd give us fullness of life. Fullness of life. Psalms 144:15 says, happy is the people whose God is the Lord. Happy is the people who God is the Lord. It doesn't say happy is he that gets the present that he wants. Right? It doesn't say happy is he that's got more money than he can spend. No. Happy is he whose God is the Lord. Hallelujah. Paul said it this way in 2 Timothy 1 and 12. He said, for I know in whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded he's able to keep every promise that he's made to me. Did you know God said he gave his promises, and he's going to keep those promises. You can lift your head. If you're sick, he said he is the healer. Amen. If you're broke spiritually, he said he is the one that's come, oh, to give us things that we need. He supplies all of our needs according to his riches and glory. But fullness of life, a happy life, a zestful life, a life, praise God, that other people will say, wow, I'd like to be smoking what he's smoking. But you ain't smoking nothing. You're high on Jesus. Woo! Hallelujah. How many know what I'm talking about today? Thank God. Thank God. You know, when you were in the world, you was out there doing the things of the world, you had a little pleasure for a season. You had a little pleasure for a season, but the season didn't last too long, did it? It runs out. But all this pleasure, this power that God gives us lasts on and on and on. Amen. My ears trying to mess up on me here. Praise God. I got to take down some more. Yeah, I know it's about off. Hallelujah. That ear's not even good enough to hold pants for. I got to put more tape in this way. Oh, praise God. Fullness of life. In him is fullness. God the Father chose to put the fullness in him. Fullness of life. He said he'd give us rest. Matthew 11, 28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. What a difference Jesus makes in people's lives. Amen. Everybody here can testify. Everybody can hear testify. But I thought about that demoniac man in the book of Mark chapter 5. Oh, nobody could tame him. He was so full of the devil that they couldn't even chain him. They couldn't even tie him up with ropes. He lived in the graveyard, lived in the tombs. But one encounter with Jesus Christ, and we find this man set free, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. Hallelujah. What a difference Jesus made in his life. What a difference Jesus made in the woman that came, that was caught in the very act of adultery in John chapter 8. And she was stoned before the feet of Jesus, trying to catch Jesus in something that they could accuse him of. And they said, what do you say about the law? The law says we should stone her. What do you say? And he didn't say anything. He just began to write on the ground in the dust. And then he stood up and said, those of you that are without sin, let them cast the first stone. You hear those big rocks just hitting the ground. And there were people walking away because Jesus knew who he was dealing with. And he knew, praise God, what to say, what to do. But that woman, oh, don't you know what a difference Jesus made in her life? And he said to her, go and sin no more. Neither do I condemn thee. In him, we have fullness of life. In him, we have rest. He gives us rest, and he makes a difference in everybody's life. Praise God. Not only does he give us reassurance, not only does he give us rest, but he gives us a race to run. Amen. Do you know you've got a purpose? You've got a purpose. God put us on this earth with a purpose. Hallelujah. And once you begin to fulfill that purpose of a man of God and a woman of God, your life will change dramatically in such a way. Amen. run the race. Hebrews chapter 12. Maybe we'll look there if you would. Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2. He said, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. And you have to read the 11th chapter to see who he's talking about there. But he said, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Looking unto Jesus. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Oh, praise God. Amen. You see, not only does he save us from the penalty of our sin, but he'll save us from the power of sin. He says we can lay aside those weights that so easily beset us. You know, people make excuses for themselves sometimes. They try to change the Word of God around to make it fit their lifestyle. They just say, well, God knows my heart. God knows what I do, you know, and he's willing to, you know, go along with it. But no, he's not. If the Word of God says it's sin, it's sin. If the Word of God says it's wrong, it's wrong. That's right. Amen. We just need to let the Word of God, that's God speaking to you. And you see, we've got a race to run, and this race needs to be run with the weights of sin to be cast aside. Weights, the habits, the things that bog us down, keep us, amen, from blooming and growing and shining for the Lord. Praise God, we can lay them down. God said we could. And looking unto Jesus, that's how it happens. Look unto Jesus. He's the author and the finisher of your faith. Amen. And once you find your race, man, oh man, praise God. I don't know what it is exactly, but once you find it, you'll know what it is. That's it. I've found it. I'm one. I'm whole. I've got purpose. I've got life. I've got joy. Amen. God. Oh, hallelujah. The fullness. Life. Fullness of life. A full life. Don't you want it? I do. I want more of it. I want more of it. He gives us a purpose. And then he gives us revelation. Amen. God's revelation is my grace is sufficient for thee. 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. Paul the Apostle, that great man of God, one day I hope to sit down nearby and maybe get to talk with him. Praise God. Won't that be something? See Paul the Apostle. See King David. Amen. See James and John. Oh, see Brother Peter. All those ones that we've read about all these times. But we sit down with him one day and have a little talk with him, you know. I don't even know if we'll remember anything about this life when we get there. It'll be so insignificant compared to what God has in store for us. I don't even know if it'll be worth mentioning. We might ask Paul, how did you go through those beatings? 5 times, he said. Amen was beaten. Amen with rods. All those times had shipwreck. But I kept going. I had a purpose. I had a revelation. God gave me a revelation. 2 Corinthians 12. He said, God, how many times am I going to have to pray to get this thorn that I have, this something that's buffeting me and keeping me beat down? What did I have to do? And God says to Paul, son, my grace is sufficient for thee. God's grace is sufficient for Paul, and it's sufficient for Richard, and it's sufficient for you here today. Praise God. God didn't make any mistakes. God don't make any junk. You're not a mistake, and you're not junk. You're made in the image of God. And if you'll get in Him for all the fullness of God, God chose to put it in Him. Who's Him? Jesus. If you'll let Jesus take control. You know, some used to have a sign, I don't see many of them anymore, that says, God is my co-pilot. But you know, you got to let him move over in the pilot seat. God's got to be your pilot. Either he's Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. But if you'll give him yourself and your heart, he'll give you an abundant life. He'll give you a fullness of life. An aim, a purpose, a power. Glory to God. Amen. Power in blood. Power in the name of Jesus. Power in prayer. I love him today, don't you?
Amen.
Praise God. These next few weeks are going to be hectic. Going to be hectic at your house. Going to be hectic maybe for you. But I tell you, they don't have to be. You can walk in the fullness of life, the fullness of God, the fullness of joy. Amen. You can do it because God says you can. And I want to pray with you today. I'm going to ask you to stand as our praise team comes back and begins to minister in the song. Oh, how good. Oh, how I love Jesus. Thank God. Thank God. Now, somebody go out here today and you start to light untangling business. I want you to pay tithes out here to this church now. Amen. It might be, you know, just one idea away from being seen. That might be one of them right there. But the greatest thing that can happen is for you to love the Lord without God with all thy heart, all thy soul and all thy mind. And love your neighbor and yourself. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus today, God, I thank you for opportunity to share the word of God, share a few thoughts. God, I ask you to touch each and every person that's here today. God, let this be the greatest season, the Christmas season of their life. Let this one be the one that stands out above all, simply because they surrendered it all to you. All to you. Because in you, we live and move. And in you is all the fullness of God. The fullness of God. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. If you're here while they begin to sing a song, play a song, if you're here, you want to pray a little something or some other need you have today, please don't leave, but come up to the altar. There'll be people that'll join with you, pray with you. I'll be happy to.